Our next speaker's laboratory is one of the world's harshest climates. She has spent more than 20 years in the Antarctic dry valleys examining how climate change affects soil biodiversity, and Wall Valley was named in honor of her achievements. A pioneer in ecosystem science, she has documented the consequences of human activity by tracing the changing life cycles of desert nematodes, roundworms. She has said that the world above ground and the world below are very tightly linked. There's a teeming organization below ground, a factory with soil animals and microbes, each with their own role. For this work, she was awarded the Tyler Prize for Environmental Achievement and was recently inducted into the Colorado Women's Hall of Fame. It is my great pleasure to introduce our Class II speaker, a university distinguished professor at Colorado State University, Diana H. Wall.
Thank you very much for the opportunity to speak on behalf of the Class II inductees. It's an honor and frankly scary to try to represent a field of biology which is so enormous. So rather than try to represent the whole field, I will talk about a shift that I've seen in biology over the course of my career. And as we tackle the big issues like climate change, we see an expansion of biology to include collaborations across disciplines and comparisons at a global scale that we didn't see to this level even 10 to 20 years ago. I first went to the Antarctic dry valleys in the late 1980s. The valleys are one of the most extreme desert ecosystems. It is one of the coldest, windiest, driest places on Earth. There's nothing flying or crawling or green that you can see. No insects or plants grow above ground. Working there is like being in a freezer. And it looks a lot like Mars, except there's less color. In a science paper in the 1970s, scientists described these valleys as having sterile soils with no life. My colleagues and I had worked in hot deserts in the United States, and we questioned that assumption. When we finally went to Antarctica, we took soil samples back to the lab and examined them under a microscope. And as you've heard, we quickly found nematodes, or roundworms, but only 3 to 4 different species. And that's what I think is so fascinating about soils. It's an unseen universe that contains nearly as many groups and phyla below ground as we see above ground, most of which are unknown and undescribed. Antarctica is a perfect place to study individual species, because there are far fewer species there in the soil than any other place on Earth. So let me pause for a second. I always have to do this and tell you a little bit more about nematodes. For the non-biologists in the room or for those who haven't paid attention to nematodes, they live in soils around the world, everywhere. They're tiny, microscopic invertebrate animals. They're smaller than your eyelash and invisible to the naked eye. And they're aquatic and live in water films around a soil particle. One single tablespoon of soil contains many different kinds of organisms and lots of species and very high numbers of nematodes. That tablespoon can have anywhere from 10 to 5,000 nematodes representing from 10 to 100 different species, just in a tablespoon. So what does this discovery mean for the big issues that we face today? We all know that climate change is happening. We're aware of the increasing rate of CO2 and other greenhouse gases in the atmosphere. This isn't a question. We hear about iconic species, such as polar bears and birds, that are being threatened or forced to adapt to change in response to climate change. But it's not just those adorable species above ground that are affected by climate change. It turns out that even the species who are so resilient that they can survive the harsh environment of the Antarctic dry valleys are also struggling to adapt to a changing climate. This is one of the most pressing issues in biology today. We must understand the myriad relationships between climate change and types and sizes of species. I want to share with you the story of one species that I've studied for 26 years in Antarctica because we know it's responding to climate change. The dominant nematode today is Scotnema, which occurs in the driest soils, but not in the wettest soils near glacial melt streams or frozen lakes. It feeds on bacteria, and I like to call it the Rambo nematode because it's very tough and resilient. It's the top dog, so to speak, in the Antarctic dry valleys. We wanted to know if Scotnema's populations would be affected with changes in temperature and moisture. We've seen these changes over the years, so we decided to conduct experiments to see how the changes would affect these soil ecosystems. What we found is that changing the moisture and the temperature, even slightly, led to a dramatic shift. Scotnema populations declined, and a different species thrived. Now, here's where people usually ask me, fascinating, but why do I care which type of nematode is dominant in such a remote place? Well, in the field, we did experiments that showed that one species is responsible for about 7% of soil carbon cycling. We know that a 65% decline in this nematode, Scotnema, over a 10 to 12 year period could reduce the soil carbon cycling by nearly one third. What scares me is that we don't know if the species that will replace this nematode will continue to store carbon or release even more. This story is bigger than soil carbon storage in Antarctica, because soil plays a vital role everywhere on Earth, and yet we know very little about the huge variety and species that comprise soil. Just like the differences in plants and animals above ground, as you move around the world, the life below it that stores carbon, cleanses water, ensures soil fertility, and regulates pest and disease, among many other benefits, is wildly different. My colleagues and I have analyzed and studied soils in places as diverse as Kenya and the plains of the Midwest to most recently Central Park in New York City, and we have found a stunning variety of ecosystems. And exactly because there are so many kinds of animals and microbes in every handful of soil, it is difficult for an ecologist to answer the basic questions about a single species in soil that we may need to know for any study of climate change. And this is what brings me back to the idea that the field of biology is changing. I work with glaciologists, geochemists, soil biogeochemists, political scientists, historians, physiologists, and many people who study molecular evolutionary biology on a regular basis. This is typical of the work that climate change scientists are doing, to find out how the different organisms in an ecosystem are responding to a changing climate and whether it matters. As our knowledge of science and biology grows, we see more and more opportunities for us to work across disciplines to tackle the most pressing global challenges of climate change, urbanization, water conservation, food security, and countless other problems. For me, it's more than watching a struggle between two nematodes in one of the most dramatic settings on Earth, though I like to do that. It's about understanding the world below our feet and the role it plays in the health of our planet and our people at large. Thank you.